Oh, hi. I'm sorry, I was just going over the script for tonight's show.
There's no script for this crap. No. No, I tell you what happened. Here, you know what this is? This is a high school book report. What happened is that I wrote a book, and someone in high school read it. Gretchen Skellinger. Gretchen in high school. She's a senior, right, at Lace Mills High School in Lake Mills High School in Lake Mills in Iowa, right? Which is, like, as everybody knows, the high school to go to. So I wrote this book, right, and Gretchen calls up my office here. Well, my office. She phoned. And got in touch with me and said, I'm doing a book report, and I want to do it on you, on your book. And I'm like, okay. And then she asked me a bunch of questions, and I answered them. And then she put it in her book report, and I said, now, send the book report to me when you get it done, and you better get an A. So she sent me the book report, and right, it's all about the questions she asked me, which is something that if you're thinking about, it's an amazing thing, because usually I talk to entertainment journalists, and the questions they ask you are, what's it like, and have you met George Clooney? But, but Gretchen asked me questions I had to think about the answer and everything. It was horrifying. And then at the end of it, she's just transcribed what we say, and she says, I say, well, listen, let me know what grade you get on it, and it better be at least be an A. And she says, oh, I'm sure it will be. And then the teacher circled it and written, hmm. And then after it, you know, she got an A, by the way. She got an A. Gretchen got an A. Oh, yes. And if you know anything about Mrs. Ham, who teaches senior English at Lake Mills High School, I'm sure your name is of no source of amusement to the students at all, Mrs. Ham. You know, with a name like Mrs. Ham, you should really be teaching second grade. They would love that. Anyway, so Mrs. Ham wrote in the end, Gretchen, great job. You asked some challenging and yet provoking questions. Also, great ambition to actually interview Craig F. And I'm thinking, well, you're wrong there, Mrs. Ham, because I think it shows a lack of ambition. Plenty of other books you could have talked to. Anyway, the thing is, actually, after that, Mrs. Ham writes, I might actually have to watch his show now. Tootsie Fruits, Mrs. Ham. Thanks very much. Please sit down, relax. Oh, thanks, you did. You can always tell when genuine, you know, when applause is genuine and they really mean it, because it doesn't just stop. I'm so happy to see you, stop. Yeah. in bad lighting when you do this, it kind of looks a little bit creepy. Remember that, kids. Hey, guess what?
What?
It's a great day for America, everybody, yes? It is a great day for America. It is also a great day for me personally. Why, I hear you ask. Not you, Jeff. Because I get my newspaper this morning. You know, the newspaper's like a big papery thing. Before computers were invented, everybody was crazy about them. Anyway, I look at the newspaper today, and I'm in the number one and number two movies in America. Me! I'm in That's right. Kick-Ass is the number one movie in America. I've got a little cameo in that. And How to Train Your Dragon is a number two movie in America. And I do a bit of voicing in that. Now, the last time a newspaper said I was involved in a number one and a number two... it was an ugly incident at a German bondage club. And I feel... That's how we met, actually. Anyway.
Love it!
I love it too, yeah. Anyway, listen to this, Jeff. Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. You especially listen and don't talk about this, Jeff. Anyway, there's a woman in Ohio, which is in America, right? An Ohio woman. She says she opened a can of Spaghetti O's and found a dead rat. Ah! I did at the end in case you thought, well, that's not so bad. Then I went, and you went, oh, so we don't like that? No, you don't like that. She found a dead rat in her can of SpaghettiOs. You know what's even more disgusting? She also found SpaghettiOs. Do they advertise on CBS? Nah, they definitely don't now, no. Anyway, this rat in a can thing is just part of Chef Boyardee's newest product, SpaghettiO, no you dentin'.
Booyah!
Nailed it! Yeah, all right, that's enough. Anyway, it's a great day for America, not such a great day for Europe. There's all the airports in Europe, from London to Warsaw, they're on their sixth day of shutdown. Nobody can fly at all. Today in the airport in Rome, it was so quiet, you could actually hear the guy in the control tower. It's like, what's a coming a go? What's a coming a go? No one a coming an a go. Anyway, the airports are closed because there's a volcano erupting. Smoke and ash is spreading all over Europe. The smoke cloud is very big and very thick. Meteorologists originally thought it was coming from Willie Nelson's tour bus, but it's not. It's from a volcano. And you can't fly an airplane through an ash plume because the engines will shut down faster than Mel Gibson at a bar mitzvah. That's how fast they would... doesn't even make sense. Does it? Like, what? Mel Gibson was... Why would he be at the... Anyway, never mind. Anyway, the reason this volcano released so much stuff into the atmosphere is because it's erupting underneath a glacier, which means everything kicks up through a hole in the ice. Now, some scientists are calling it an ice hole, but other... Can we at least get to the bit where we know I'm going? Some scientists are calling it an ice hole, but other scientists are saying that the problem is pre-existing ash in the crater. Therefore, it's more of an ash hole. And as we all know, most of the problems in this world are caused by... Anyway, the name of the erupting volcano is very difficult to pronounce. I've practiced it over and over again. I think I've got it right. It's called... Now, it's in Iceland. I like Iceland because, you know, the name tells you what you're going to get. Iceland. It's like that town in Pennsylvania, Intercourse. That's a real place, Intercourse. It's right after Foreplayville. I've been to Foreplayville. I didn't care for it. It's not necessary. Mind you, it's not as boring as Spooningburg. What I like about you is... Anyway, thousands of European travellers have been stuck for days at the airports waiting for flights. Now, most people are taking it all in their stride. There's no hard feelings, especially in Scotland. Here is an actual news report from Edinburgh Airport. Look at this.
You only found out when you got to the airport. You didn't know in your hotel.
Or... No. I hate Iceland!
Man, you got a lot of stag parties leaving Edinburgh at this time of the morning. A lot of drink taken in the early hours as well.
That's where I'm from. Do you see that guy? The guy in the background, I hate Iceland. That's my sister. Dude, the guy that was saying that, I hate Iceland, do you see what he was wearing? He was wearing the traditional Scottish outfit of a sweatshirt with Hooters written on. Take that, Braveheart costume designers. Anyway, very little of the ash has actually fallen on mainland Europe. So far, it's only the ash has only come down in Britain. So conditions are just miserable. Everything's grey, people are coughing, you can't see 15 foot in front of you. And then the volcano erupted and things have gotten really bad. Things are so bad that the British Navy is going to bring stranded passengers back from Spain. So you can get where you're going, but you're also going to get scurvy. That's right, the British Navy is still using 18th century frigates. It isn't just affecting airline passengers, though. Airline flight crews are stranded too. There's 1,500 flight crew members stranded at faraway airports and no way to get home. And I kind of like thinking about that. All those flight attendants from Air Sweden all crammed into a tiny little hotel room. No choice but to shower together. And it can't be easy for the women either. I mean, what's it going to be like? All right, well, it's time for a big commercial break. And, you know, I'm looking forward, because I think it's SpaghettiOs today, isn't it?
Uh-oh.
Oh, that's right. We'll take a break. We'll be right back.
A compost pit is a great way to provide your garden with nutrition. You fill it with food scraps, grass clippings, and manure, and you let it sit there for a while. And you know it's ready when it starts to smell like Craig Ferguson.
Hey, I heard that.
Yeah, that's it. That's the good stuff.
Damn show gets more like hee-haw every night. Hey, do you know the last week, Rush Limbaugh said that the volcanic eruption in Iceland might be God punishing us for healthcare reform? I agree with Rush quite a lot, actually. You, a lot of people give Rush a hard time. I agree with them sometimes. For example, I think that OxyContin is a very mellow high and adorable, but I... agree with them this time. Why would a volcano erupt because of what the US Senate did in Iceland? It's more likely erupting because of something that happened in Iceland, surely. Like, for example, this. Maybe you want to think about that next time, Iceland. Every time a strip club closes, an angel loses its wings. What time is it, Jeff?
Check that tweet and check that 8 Mile.
All right, then, do the, what's his name?
Know me all better, cause you ain't a quitter. I'm a baby sinner. Check damn Twitter. Check them tweets. And also emails.
I look forward to your letters. All right, let's see. This is a tweet from Felice in Manila. There she is there. There's a lovely girl. Felice says, Craig, you overcame your fear of flying by becoming a pilot. How can I overcome my fear of birds? By becoming a pilot. She'll be able to get above them. And look down on them like they've always looked down on you. I know you're thinking, Craig, that's not very good acting. And I think, oh, yeah? Are you in the number one and number two movies in the country? Now, to be fair, in one of those movies I play myself and the other one I'm a cartoon, but still. All right, here's another tweet. This is from Eric in Brookings. There he is there, big tall fella. Eric says, is there a right way or a wrong way to eat a crispy taco? Crispy taco? No. I think we'll just leave it at that. We'll just leave it at that. We'll be right back after the break. Welcome back. My next guest, my first guest, my only guest, one of my guests this evening. There's a guest coming out, and he's a movie star. He's got a new film called Furry Vengeance.
Love it!
Yeah, all right. It's in theaters April the 30th. Take a look at this clip.
It's on!
Hi there, cutie pie. Who's the pretty birdie? Oh, you are cute. You make pretty sounds. That's a nice little song you're singing. Do any more? I wonder what it would sound like. With your beak wrapped in duct tape.
Please welcome Brendan Fraser, everybody. Brendan Fraser. You're fantastic?
I'm so happy to be here. I'm so happy. Can I first just say hi to my dad? Hi, Dad. He's up in Seattle. Because he
lives... What the hell are you doing? You're a movie star. You don't go on TV and go, oh, can I say hi to my dad?
No, but you're Craig Ferguson. He's been bugging me for years, saying, when are you going to go on a Craig Ferguson show?
Is your dad a drunken Scotsman?
And he is a Fraser.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a Scottish name. There's a fair chance.
I don't know about the drinky bit, but...
Well, actually, you know, Fraser's is a big department store in Glasgow. There's a...
House of Fraser?
Yeah, House of Fraser. Yeah, they have... You can get a sweater there.
A scarf. There's a Fraser tartan.
You can get, you can get a hoodie with Hooters written on it.
Do you think he actually came from Hooters?
I don't know what he was saying.
I can't.
I don't know if there is a Hooters in Scotland.
Like, where's the Hooters in...
I don't know. Listen, if they'd have had one, I don't think I'd have left. So I... if they've got one, it's new. That's all I'm saying. Now, listen, in this movie, did you hurt your testicles?
Just my feelings.
Yeah. Oh, really? Did you wear a special testicle guard?
There's
Or did you just clench just before you hit the?
There is. Do you want to know how it's done?
Sure. Okay.
So there's a strap that goes from, like, runs up there across the engine.
Oh, hey, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it goes to the other side, like, yeah.
Yeah, right.
So that when you take the blow, it.
Hey, hey, hey!
Did I say?
Yeah. Your dad will be proud. No, I tell you that. So listen, I want to talk to you about this volcano in Iceland because you've been to Iceland, haven't you?
Yeah, I have. I've been down to the center of the earth.
That's right. In that movie, Journey to the Center of the Earth, you went to Iceland.
I did.
So, did you notice the volcano when you were there?
I guess it might have been something like I might have left a toaster running or something while I was down there. I don't know.
You took a toaster to the center of the earth?
How are you going to make toast?
Lava toast?
An English muffin?
Okay. Anyway, look, I've got a theory about your movies, by the way. I want to talk to you about them. I think you've done a lot of movies where you're underground.
Yes, I come to think of it.
Encino Man, underground, a bit.
Yeah, mostly.
Right, the beginning of your career, you were underground. Right. That one where you were under in the bunker for a while?
Blast from the Past.
Underground, right?
Underground.
In The Mummy, lot of underground stuff going on there.
Underground.
Journey to the Center of Earth, underground.
Underground.
Maybe it's time you do some flying movies, is what I'm saying.
So I can stay above the birds.
That's what I. But I look down on them
and
like they look down on you.
There's birds in this movie I'm in, Furry Vengeance, which.
Is this a romantic movie about you and a raccoon? Is that right?
I'm trying. It's not exactly like a bromance. It's. Gosh, help me out here.
It's like I love you, man, but with a raccoon.
Well, the raccoon does bite me between the pockets in one sequence.
Oh.
There's an absolute throwdown. And I wind up fighting with the raccoon, but because the actors were never in the same shot as, you know, the creatures, because we would composite in with.
Right, you got to do it later on. I know how movies work. I'm in the top two movies in the United States.
Right there, number two. I've completely forgotten what I was going to tell you.
Well, you were going to say that in the movie, like, you worked with this raccoon.
Yes, and the raccoon is out to get me because my character, Dan Sanders, is a well-meaning guy. He is slightly misprioritized, and he's given its task to, you know, put some houses at the end of a cul-de-sac, but then his boss, played by Ken Jeong, who you recall from The Hangover, he jumped out of the trunk.
Oh, yeah, the nude guy in the trunk.
He did have he had a crowbar.
He did have
a crowbar. He's my boss. He's a baddie. And he's a great guy. You know, he's an MD.
He's a doctor?
He's an MD.
Wow.
He was the first guy to say, I forgot the prescription pad today.
Yeah, I mean, wow.
True. True story.
What's a doctor doing jumping out of a trunk nude in Vegas? Happens all the time,
getting
actually.
Paid?
Anything about it.
No.
So listen, in the movie that you have this relationship, you have to get these houses, then the boss and then the dean of the college is going nuts.
The dean would be the raccoon because he rallies the forces and all of them are.
The forces of nature combine against you?
Yes, can you?
Oh man!
Do not mess with them. As we come to the movie, you'll find out why. This was actually.
Did you actually work with the animals? Did you have raccoons attached to your bits?
My parts.
Yeah. I mean, did you even meet them?
No. What I met was a stuffy. Oh, I met him. He was called Scooby or something like that.
Not Dude.
But close. I had a stuffy, and the stuffy beats me up. In a historical reenactment sequence.
Civil War?
Many times. Close. Puritans.
The Puritans.
All the way back to cavemen.
And there you go again!
I told you.
With the under the ground!
Right, precisely. But it was chopsticks that had paws on it. And
we do a lot of the show here like that. We do.
That's the movie magic.
Chopsticks.
I beat myself
with
up with pod chopsticks.
Pod chopsticks. That's a movie I saw once. It's about this guy who's underground and. No, listen, anyway, it looks funny. Is it for the kids?
It's for the kids. It's not the kind of movie. I am a dad. I've got three sons.
Right.
I I promise. Stick around for the credits. Seriously, it's big fun. Everyone takes...
Well, if you pay your money, you might as well. That's
yeah,
what
you're not going to bolt for the aisle. Yeah, you know? Like, yeah. I guarantee everyone's going to have a good time. And you won't feel like, you know, you want to smash yourself the ball-peen hammer on some of the kids' movies that adults are...
You're not talking about How to Train Your Dragon here, right?
No, because that's the number one movie. No,
that's the number two movie. The other one, I mean, is the number one movie. That's called Kick-Ass. That is not a kid's movie.
No, you want to make sure you see that.
Yeah.
Twice, and then go to Furry Vengeance.
I think Furry Vengeance is the one I'll be going to this weekend because I've got a kid. Now, is it the PGs?
It's PG. Yes, it is.
All right,
it is
good.
The PGs.
All right, good.
We squeaked in the PG.
The big, probably later in the week show. My next guest is an actress.
Ooh.
Hey! My next guest is a very lovely actress. She stars in The Mentalist, which is on Thursdays at 10 o'clock on CBS. Please welcome the very lovely Amanda Righetti, everybody. Amanda Righetti. Welcome, Amanda. Did the stage move when you come up?
It rumbled.
It wobbled? Did it?
It rumbled.
Well, yeah. It's very... I know this stuff looks very expensive. I know it looks like a very high-tech, sophisticated operation, but really, not so much.
Yeah.
So it probably moved a little bit as well. Can I just compliment you on your ring?
Hey, thanks.
Wow, look at that.
It kind of matches your mug, but with
no, I can't tell you how glad I am my doctor doesn't have one of those. Yeah, it'd be very. That's not something you want to see going in. Hi, how have you been? How have you been, doctor? Oh, great! I got a new ring. Oh. Yeah. No. Hey, listen. You look great. Are you having a nice time on The Mentalist?
Yes, I am.
Really?
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. We're doing well.
Now, what happens is that he's mental and he solves crimes.
I know. It can be misconstrued, can't it?
Right. A little bit.
No, he used to be a psychic, but he's not a psychic anymore.
He kind of saw that was, you know, not going to work out for him.
It was a dead-end track, yeah. So he has these powers of observing and manipulating situations to get information. So.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
And what do you do in it?
I'm kind of the sidekick rookie.
Hot girl sidekick rookie, maybe? Yeah. And is it in Las Vegas, like the CSI? Do you do it there?
Not quite. It takes place in California. Sacramento.
Sacramento?
Yeah. Ever been?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's lovely.
Mm.
Yeah. Hey, did you ever go to Las Vegas?
Yeah, I grew up in Vegas.
You never?
Yeah.
Is that where you got the ring, Las Vegas?
Not quite. Although I wish I had.
Where did you go? Did you grow up in near Lovett's Frozen Custard, next to the Stratosphere?
No, but I actually have a sister that used to work at the Stratosphere.
In the Stratosphere?
Yeah.
What did she do?
She was a dealer. Blackjack.
Oh, I thought you were going to say heroin.
That could be that, too, you know.
Yeah, that'd be bad. Hey, come here, buddy. Hey, come here. Really? She's a blackjack dealer?
Yeah. Well, she does, and she did roulette and stuff like that, but she does a lot of managing now on the floor. She works in Palm Springs now.
Wow.
Yeah.
Do you come from then a kind of Vegas family? And by family, I mean, are you connected in any way to the mafia?
Maybe 6 degrees of separation.
Right.
I don't know.
Were you never interested in life in the casinos yourself?
Not the casinos per se, but I did dabble with the idea of dancing one of the shows for a while.
Which show are we talking about?
I don't know.
I'll go. I'll pay. I'll go see it.
No, yeah, I my sister dances in Lance Burton show, so.
Oh, Lance Burton, oh, a magician dance. Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
You like magic, don't you?
Oh, I love magic. Lance Burton's been here. He made stuff disappear. Yeah. There were dancers, I believe. Maybe your sister was even here. It's I don't know why I'm getting so enthusiastic about this, but I am.
She wears a Scottish outfit in the show.
I don't recall that part.
Right.
Really, what is a Scottish outfit for a woman?
I don't know.
Because where I come from, it's a heavy coat and a miserable attitude.
Yeah,
so
well, I guess it's a Scottish wannabe. It was, you know, one of those, like...
A little mini kilt?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah, that works for you. Yeah, that's all right. Yeah, that's good. Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Do you like magicians? Do you enjoy magic?
Yeah, I enjoy watching magic.
Really? Can you perform any magic?
I wish I could, no.
No.
I have no tricks.
Well, I don't know about that, but I...
Magic tricks.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so you grew up in Vegas, then you came here.
I did,
That's kind of the opposite, because most people, when they come to L.A., they go, oh, this place is seedy. But if you come from Vegas, you probably go, oh, it's quite nice
exactly.
here. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially.
Did you grow up in the nice part of Vegas? Is there a nice part?
Ish.
Yeah?
Yeah. Henderson.
I know Henderson. Yeah. Henderson's lovely. They've got a little airport there in Henderson.
They do. It's a private airport.
Yes, that's right. I've landed there in a little Cessna, and it gets very bumpy and turbulent on the way in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can tell you exactly where the bathroom is in relation to the runway. If you know.
Whoops.
Do the folks at CBS treat you well? Because I know they treat me awfully well.
Do they treat you awfully well?
Awfully well.
I bet they treat me just as good as they treat you.
Do they? No, I don't know.
Yeah, I bet they do.
Did you go to the Super Bowl?
No.
Did you get asked?
No.
Well, yeah, it's about the same as me then.
Yeah.
That's right, you heard me, you. Hey, what about, are you interested in the Super Bowl? Are you interested in the football?
Yeah, I mean, I've been to one game before.
A Super Bowl game?
Yeah.
What one?
The one that was, it was in Louisiana, the Saints. I don't know who it was against, because
well, you've come to the wrong place
ago.
As well, because
exactly,
But it was in New Orleans?
It was in New Orleans.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
You like to drink to excess? That's
exactly,
a great place to do that.
It was a lot of fun. They had the halftime show and all that stuff. And
yeah, they always have that. Every Super Bowl.
I don't really watch it when it's on TV.
Really?
The halftime show.
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. The Who were on it this year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How was that?
I loved The Who, and I still, you know, I love the legacy of The Who and stuff, and I think they're a great, a milestone in rock history. But when I was watching them at the Super Bowl, I thought, oh, this is like watching my grandpa play the spoons.
It's kind of like the geriatric society.
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, they're great. I don't mean in any way to take away from how wonderful our space. I mean, I saw that band in Glasgow Apollo in, it must have been 1978, 77, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And they were great, but we were all great then.
Sure. Were you high too?
Was I high? No, I was about 15 then.
Oh, right.
So, yeah. Yeah.
It makes it all better, right?
You ever been over there to Glasgow?
I have not.
No. You'd like it.
Yeah. Wow.
I kind of painted you into a corner with this whole drink.
Yeah. I don't know how to.
Oh, it's all
out,
right.
Thanks,
I'm only kidding. It's not really true.
No, it's not.
Or is it?
Or is it?
I think it's all right. Yeah. So we're out of time. But I do like that ring.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, it's good.
I don't think it would fit you.
No, it wouldn't fit me. I've got big sausagey fingers.
Yeah. Maybe on your pinky.
Even my pinky is a bit sausagey. It's like I've got 2 pounds of sausages.
How's that working out for you?
Some girls like it.
Yeah.
But I need, I don't know quite how to put it.
Well, you're just gonna have to open your mouth and say it out loud in full detail. Like you're talking to your priest. You show me yours, I'll show you mine. That's how it works.
Here. I want you to kill him. How much do you charge?
Is a very funny comedian, as opposed to many of the comedians that we've had on. We only have funny comedians here. This newfangled type of comedian that comes on and just tells you stuff and makes you sad. We have none of that here. He's very funny. We can catch him. You can catch him at the comic strip in New York. Brian Scott McFadden, everybody. Brian Scott McFadden.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. It is terrific to be here in Los Angeles, because back in New York, I just broke up with a woman who lives in my building. Yeah, so it is really great to be here. Because she's Russian, she's jealous, and now I have to sneak other dates through the lobby like the witness protection program. Because she saw me with another girl after we broke up. Next day, I see her in the laundry room, like, hey, Anna, did the mail guy come today? Why don't you get your whore to get your mail? I guess that's a no then, huh? Can I get my laundry? What, your whore doesn't do your laundry? Well, she's already getting the mail, you know. I don't want to ask her to multitask. She used to work for CNN, and I love CNN. My favorite thing on CNN is when they hire the BBC reporters to do the disaster stories, famine, civil war, genocide stories, and all the stories sound exactly the same. They always have that one guy that comes on. A young child wanders the streets of a mud-cracked hillside. His tear-stained face and the gunfire tells the story. For a tragedy has taken hold here that has crippled this once peaceful village. A tragedy that appears to have no end. Hakimi is a local tribesman. I don't know what I will do. Things are very bad here now. This was a peaceful place to live, but we are terrified. How will we feed our families? Anger has turned to fear here. The provisional government seems helpless to stop the bloodshed. And if supplies do not arrive soon, all may be lost. But there are no winners or losers here. Just the sad people staring into an uncertain future. Brian Kittle, CNN, Sri Lanka. Who is that guy? Every story. He's on every story, except he's never on the local news. I always wondered why that was. And I figured it out, because we don't have that stuff in America. We're pretty lucky. They have famine, civil war, genocide in other countries. I live in New York City. We had a doorman strike, and people freaked out. How's that for perspective, you know? People in other countries don't even have doors, much less a guy whose only job it is to open it for you. That's why they never let that CNN guy cover the local news, because a doorman strike would not nearly have the same tragic ring to it. An old man shuffles the lobby of a posh Upper East Side apartment building, unable to get outside. For a strike has taken hold here, one that has pitted neighbor against neighbor in a struggle to survive. Mr. Rosenberg has lived here for 35 years.
I don't know what the hell to do. You come down, you can't get out the damn door here. I pay my rent. When are they going to settle this thing? I come in, they're yelling, they're picketing, they're screaming at me. Settle it, damn it.
Anger has turned to fear here. The strike has affected everything here. An order of Chinese food arrives. But there is no one there to greet him. Some of these yuppies have not eaten takeout in weeks. Even the delivery man is angry. Unga dao, unta banga dao. But the hunger no unga na hama na na how. I don't know what I will do. Things are very bad here now. How will we feed our families? One local woman seemed especially angry. Why doesn't he just get his whore to open the door for him? Another sad victim. Brian Kittle, CNN, Park Avenue. Thank you very much. Thank you.
What did we learn on the show tonight, Greg?
I gotta be quick, so no mucking around. No, I'll just do it quick. We gotta go. Good night, everybody. Good night.